Hello again, my name is Wesbam, and welcome to part 3 of our little clock project. In the previous two lessons, I showed you how to make a clock and use some textures to make it look good. Now today, we're gonna make it look more real by adding some shadows to these clock hands. So they look more like the alarm clock hand, which is still the original from the picture I used. Now to do this, you have to be sure to have installed the add-on pack. And to be honest, always install the add-on pack if you install VVVV. So let's jump to VVVV.org and underneath downloads, you can download your add-on pack for your version of V4. So you download the add-ons pack and then you simply unzip all the content in your V4 folder so it looks like this. Okay, next to make it work, we need to be sure to restart our patch. So I quit this and I reopen it. And then I press Ctrl I for my inspector. And we are good to go. Okay, the shadows. Well, I only want the shadow on the clock hand. So I need a way to separate the clock hands from the background picture. The problem is that I cannot use a get slice for the quad, because once all the transforms and textures are connected to the quad, it is still just one quad. So to separate this, I will need to make another quad and then get the correct file texture and transforms to them. But first we're gonna make another renderer and quad to see the result. So I just double left click, type in quad, and I make another renderer EX9, and I make the connection, and let's move it aside. And let's scale it up. We can use a get slice node again. Well, we need two, one for the textures and one for the transforms. But since I only want to split the first slice, that's the background, from the rest of the transforms, I can use another cool node. And that node is the car transforms. A car node will give you the first slice and the remainder. And if you wonder, the opposite of the car is the CDR, which will give the last slice and the remainder. But we're gonna use the car node. So let's send the first transform to our old quad and the remainder goes to our new quad. Okay, this looks weird, but that is because we are sending 5 textures and they are all the same size as the background of our clock, because we only used one transform this time. So let's do something similar for the textures. Well, it is too bad we don't have a car texture node. So we need to do this by hand using a get slice node. So I just duplicate this node, I select it and hit Ctrl D. And let's connect it to the file texture node. And I connect it to our old quad. Now you see only the cap, but I want to get the background and that's slice number 1. So if I change this to A1, we only got our background. Well, for the other one, I duplicate this IO box value, so I know the values I need. And now I'm just going to select this IO box value, which is already connected. And in Head Inspector over here, I'm gonna change it to 4 rows. And now I just type in by hand the order that I need. That's 2, 3, 4 and 0. And if I now connect this get slice to the quad, our clock hands and background are separated. Now it's a bit ugly, so I'm gonna make this, I right click and drag up a dark gray color so we can see it a bit better. And here is all our stuff separated. Now I can delete this and let's try and make some space here. Normally I would just right click and drag around my patch. But for this tutorial, I want you guys all to see everything. So I'm just gonna move everything aside for now. So we got enough space here to continue our lesson. Now, before I make the shadow, I want to show you how to get the clock hands back to the clock again. The thing we're going to use to do this is called a render pass. And I'm going to make this renderer and everything in it as a texture. And everything that passes that renderer will remain in the memory of our graphics card, so it should run very fast. So let's make the node that creates a texture out of our renderer. That node is the DX9 texture node. And as you can see here, the last pin of the renderer is called EXOut. And that's the only pin I can connect to the DX9 texture node. So let's do that. And let me move everything up here to make it even more clearer to see. Okay, now we got our renderer as a texture, and to show it, I need to make yet another quad. So let's just do that. I'm gonna make a quad DX9, and then I'm gonna put my new texture on the quad. And if I middle mouse click here on the old quad, I get a group node, and I can connect that to my renderer. And then I can connect my new quad to the group node. And here you can see we got our clock hands back on our background picture. Now, of course, it's a bit small, but that's just the default size of our quad. So let's scale it up. I make a scale node and set the X and Y to 2. So scale transform, connect it to the quad, X 2 and Y 2. And now our quad is the size of the renderer. But as you can see, we still got another problem, and that is that the quad is not transparent. Well, it isn't the quad that's not transparent. It's the texture that's not transparent. And that is because our renderer was not transparent. If I hover above the background color, you will see the alpha is set to 100. So let's make it transparent. I'm going to make a note, set alpha color. And I'm going to connect it to the renderer. And I put the alpha value to 0. And let's make it light gray so we can see it a bit better. That's right click and drag up. And it's still not transparent. And that is because we need to do one more step. The texture format that we are using by default does not support alpha. And the DX9 node has no pins, as you can see. But if you look here in Hair Inspector, you can see there are some hidden options. That's the white color over here. And the secret pin is the format pin. And if I right click this little arrow, you see a list with all the texture formats we can choose from. And I have no idea what most of these mean, but I do know that if I select one that starts with the letter A, I will get a format that supports alpha. And this one, A8, R8, G8, B8, always worked for me. So I select that, and poof, our clock is back to the original state. But it's not really back to our original state, because if you look closely, and let me put this on full screen, that is Alt Enter, you see it's very ugly and blurred and pixelated. Well, and this ugly look is because our texture is the wrong size. So if I press Alt Enter again to get out of this mode, and then I look at the renderer, and let me make Hair Inspector a bit bigger so we can see it. Here you see the actual back buffer width and the actual back buffer height, and that's just the size of my renderer on the screen. Now, of course, I'm recording this in full HD, and I want to make my back buffer width and height also full HD. So to do that, you can set these two pins, that's back buffer width and back buffer height, to become more HD. So let me scale up my renderer node, so I got more space to reach my pins, and I right click to make an IO box value advanced. And then I select back buffer width and back buffer height. And I'm working in full HD, so that's 1920 by 1080. And if I now look at Hair Inspector, our actual width and height are full HD. And if I now select my clock and I press Alt Enter, you should see it looks way more sharp now. So these are the hidden pins you want to use if you want to make a render pass. And now you know where to look. So let me press Alt Enter again. So now we don't have a real need to see this renderer. So we can close it. So if I select the renderer and hit Alt 3, my renderer is closed and I don't really have to worry about it. Okay, now it's time to make a shadow. The node that we need is called the Drop Shadow Texture Filter. And it's made by a user named UNC or Unk. I met him once, it's a very nice person, and it's a very cool effect, and he made a whole list of effects. So it's really worth checking out all these texture filters in the add-on pack. But for now, we're gonna select Drop Shadow. So I'm gonna select my texture to the Drop Shadow module, and the output is also a texture. So I can connect this to my quad, and here you got a shadow. Now, it looks a bit ugly, so let's tweak some values. I'm gonna double right click to make an IO box value advanced, and I click away, and I'm gonna connect this to my alpha pin, that's the transparency, just tweak some values, and if I middle mouse click here, I get the name, so I know what I'm doing. Let's make another one for the angle. It's now 0. And if I play with the angle pin, you see where my shadow is going. And I want to make it look like our original alarm clock hand. So I think around this will be fine. And I'm going to make another one. That's for the offset or the distance. Very close. This is perfect. And I'm going to make another one for the blur. You see, it comes very hard. And if I drag it all the way up, the shadow becomes more soft or blurred. Middle mouse, middle mouse. And let's scale up the node so we can reach the pins a bit better. Now, let's work on the color. The default is black. But I think and I know that a dark brown will do better in this case. So let's make a dark brown color. I'm going to make the HSV node color join because I want to join some values to make a color. And I'm also going to make an IO box color. I just double right click and pick color and connect it to the HSV so I can see what I'm doing. And let's make a brown color saturation. First, let's find an orange color. I right click and drag down until I find orange. I think this is nice. I'm going to make it a bit darker. And I'm also going to remove some saturation to make it even more brownish. And I think this looks okay. And now I can just play with some values to make it look better. I think it's too much blur for now. Oh, and of course we need to connect our color to our drop shadow. And here we finally have our clock back again with some nice looking shadows. So if I select the clock and press Alt Enter to see it in full screen. I think it looks pretty cool and it's hard to see which are the original clock hands and which are the ones that we added and rotated inside V4. And let me press Alt Enter again. Now there are many, many more texture filters and you should really check them out. If you just type in filter, you see a whole bunch of texture filters. We got blurs, we got a shadow, we got glows. And this list goes on. And it's a very good job by our user UNC. So I really, really suggest you play with these filters and see what they do. And now you know how to use them. Well, that's it for me again. My name is Wes Bam. Thanks again for watching. And I hope to see you all next time.